Hello and good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to GS Core. My name is Kapil Chaudhary. In this session, we are going to discuss how to decode the syllabus of geography. Now, you must be thinking that what is the need for decoding the syllabus for geography when the syllabus has been already given by UPSC? Now, the thing is that the very fact is that the syllabus which has been given by UPSC is very open-ended. It's not very descriptive, it's not elaborated. So, when you go through the syllabus of UPSC, you tend to read everything under the sun. So, in order to define, so it's very much necessary to define a definite boundary so that your preparation is in a streamlined path. Because you have so many subjects to read, you have history, you have economics, you have polity, you have society, you have environment and ecology. So, geography is not the only subject which you have to study for civil services, and you have stipulated time in your hand. You have to clear this exam in 1 year, let's say 1 year or 2 years. So, setting a boundary, setting a well-defined boundary is of paramount importance for geography. So, that is why this session we have designed particularly for this purpose. So, as we have said, it's not very descriptive. So, in this session, we'll set a well-defined boundary for geography so that we'll come to know that what all areas we need to cover for geography, and no question will come out of those areas because the syllabus which has been given by UPSC is not enough. That will not guide us properly. Now, after that, my second question to you is that what is geography? I'll not delve deeper into this because I'll not ask any technical definition to you. I'll just ask a very basic definition. What do you understand by geography? Because why I am asking this question is that this will guide us to understand the basic requirement, the scope of geography, how the UPSC has designed the syllabus for geography. Geography has been defined as, you know that geography is made up of two words, geo plus graphy. Geo, you must be knowing that geo stands for earth and graphy stands for its description. Geography, that means, so the basic definition of geography is that geography is description of earth, but the most modern or the more accurate definition of geography is that geography is description of earth as home of human beings. So that is why geography more accurately deals with the study of earth as well as study of human beings, because human beings, they are related to earth also, because nature and human beings, they are interdependent. Earth and human beings, they are interdependent. That is why in geography, we study human aspects also. So, very quickly, I'll summarize that in geography, what we are going to do, or what is the broad syllabus of geography? So, earth aspect covers the physical geography. Physical geography, and the human aspect comes under human geography. So, you have two components which falls under, these are the two broad components which falls under geography. We need to study physical geography as well as human geography. Now, physical geography has further subcomponents like geomorphology, climatology, oceanography, biogeography, etc. In human geography, we have economic geography, we have social geography. So, we will not discuss in detail, but this is how we are going to proceed for geography, and this is how the syllabus has been defined, or the syllabus has been designed by UPSC. Now, physical geography, we need to study in the context of world also, in the context of India also, as well as human geography also, we need to study in context of world as well as in the context of India. So both these have to be studied in the context of world as well as India. That is world geography as well as Indian geography. So this is how we are going to proceed forward, and very soon we will see how the UPSC has given its syllabus and how we are going to decode it in order to make it more elaborate. All right. When you study physical geography and human geography, let me tell you, physical geography is very fundamental and conceptual part of geography. Human geography is more applied in nature. Your concepts of human geography more or less rests upon physical geography. More time will be consumed in understanding the concepts of physical geography, because this is presumably more difficult also. Most of the students consider physical geography to be more difficult, and to a certain extent this notion is correct also, that physical geography, because it is more scientific, this is more conceptual also. If your fundamentals are clear in physical geography, then your fundamentals of human geography will become crystal clear, because you can correlate the aspects, you can integrate the aspects which you learn in human geography if your fundamentals, if your concepts of physical geography are very clear. See, in UPSC you just need to understand. This is the beauty of UPSC, that you don't need to cram, you don't need to mug up the facts, or you don't need to mug up the concepts, you just need to understand. As Einstein has said, any fool can know, but the point is to understand, and this is very much apt for UPSC. You have to understand for UPSC. This is like no other exam. In UPSC you need to understand the concepts. If you understand the concepts, if you visualize the concepts, then you are good to go for this exam. Now after that, I would like to draw your point to this very important point, that connecting the dots. Once you have understood the points, once you have understood the various phenomena, the various concepts, the various facts and figures, then you need to learn this art of connecting the dots. The various facts and figures, the various concepts, whichever you have learned here and there, that is in physical geography or economic geography or in social geography or in climatology, let's say, or in geomorphology or in oceanography, then you should learn this art of connecting the dots and to see the holistic picture of entire geography. Then only you'll get very good marks in the exam. Not only geography, but sometimes you can incorporate the concepts you learn in other subjects also. For example, history, you can incorporate points from history also. And connecting the dots means, while going through the syllabus of UPSC, you can connect the dots from other points or other topics or subtopics which are given in the syllabus of other areas, like other subjects, to geography. So you need to see the holistic picture of the entire syllabus which has been given by the UPSC. Connecting dots is not only important for deciphering the syllabus for UPSC, not only for geography, but for entire syllabus of your general studies, but for your answer writing also. When you learn this skill, when you learn this, you cultivate this habit of connecting the dots or seeing the holistic picture, then your half work is done. You write very incredible answers, multi-dimensional answers, and you get exceptionally good marks. And that makes the difference between the toppers and the people who don't get very good ranks, or the people who don't get selected in the exam. All right. Now, in answer writing also, connecting dots, we have discussed. Once you learn this connecting the dots, skill of connecting the dots, then entire picture becomes clear in front of you, and it just emerges out clearly. And when it becomes clear, then only you'll get good marks. And our ultimate objective in UPSC is what? It's getting marks. Because then only we'll get selected, finally. All right. Let's design now, inch by inch, slowly, slowly we'll design. We'll proceed towards, now we are proceeding towards decoding the syllabus. We'll make a strategy how to decode the syllabus. First of all, the syllabus given by the UPSC, that is the most important. The syllabus as it is, whether it is open-ended, whether it is cut short, whether it is not enough, or even then it is very important. You take a printout of the syllabus of geography, you paste it on the wall, make it a habit to read it several times in the day, at least twice in the day, so that each and every word of the syllabus gets embedded in your head. Why I am saying so? Because this will help you to select the important issues, important articles, important news pieces in the newspapers, in your magazines like Yojana, in various other magazines, that what to pick out for your geography. Because various questions are asked from current affairs, from contemporary areas. So this is how you connect it from your syllabus. Because your syllabus doesn't mean that all the questions would be asked from your conventional textbooks only, from your basic textbooks only. Many of the questions could be asked from contemporary areas. So you need to have every word of the syllabus in your mind. So as soon as you are like reading newspaper, as soon as you see some important current affair pertaining to geography, you just make it a point that, okay, this is important for geography, and you note it down in your diary or wherever, you make a repository of that. This is how you take the help of the syllabus, and this will also help you in decoding the syllabus also, because we'll elaborate our syllabus or we'll decode the syllabus out of the syllabus which has been given by UPSC only. Now, questions from the past. This is also of very much importance. This will also help us in decoding the syllabus to a certain extent, and this will also help us in knowing what kind of questions UPSC gives usually. Though the trend keeps on changing several few years, questions from the past, how you should go about this? I would not say that you should follow questions from the past, like past 25 years, but follow questions from the past, like you should refer the questions from past from 2011 onwards when CSAT was introduced, or you can follow questions from 2013 also when new syllabus was introduced. It's better that you follow questions from 2011 onwards, because when you go through the questions from the past, then you will get an idea that what kind of questions UPSC gives. These questions are very different from the questions which are asked usually in university exams or in school exams. These are highly analytical questions. These are very conceptual questions. These are very thought-provocative questions. Though some of the questions may be factual, but those factual questions are factual for everyone. And the serious candidates, the candidates who really want to get selected, who are vying for a seat in UPSC Civil Services, they are not preparing for those factual questions, because everybody is going to solve invariably those factual questions. You are preparing for those tough, those difficult questions, those analytical questions. You have to learn this art of analyzing also, of thinking. How to connect the dots, how to think then and there in the exam, how to correlate different aspects. So now, questions from the past, I'm not saying that you start solving the question from the past. What I am saying is that this will give you an idea that what kind of questions UPSC usually asks, first of all. Secondly, you just read the questions, do not try to understand the questions, read them several times, whether you have done geography or not, whether you have understood geography or not. After you have done that particular topic from geography, then try to solve that question. Or in your class, your teacher will help you solving those questions. But at least you will get a hang of those questions, and you'll get a direction that how to read the books. Okay, I'm reading this book. You'll definitely get an idea, okay, this is important because UPSC has asked this question. You'll get an idea, okay, this is how I am supposed to read this book, or I am supposed to read this newspaper, because UPSC asks question in such a way. We'll see examples how the questions from the past also will help us in decoding the syllabus, also will help us in preparing for the future questions. Then consult experts. Do not consult so many people that how to prepare, how to decode the syllabus, or which books to follow, which books not to follow, because it's said that too many cooks spoil the porridge. So it's better to consult the experts, the teachers who are experts in the field, or your seniors who have got selected in civil services, or your seniors who have not even got selected in the civil services, who have faced the interview. They can also guide you very properly, because they know where they have committed the mistake. Then keep your enemy closer than your friends. Now, whom I am referring to as enemy? Enemy over here is UPSC. Now, don't take it in a negative sense. UPSC is our enemy because we are at war with UPSC right now. UPSC is our opponent. UPSC is designing the questions, and we are supposed to tackle those questions. So that is why UPSC is our enemy, and why we have to keep a close watch at UPSC, because every now and then UPSC changes pattern, changes its trend, typology of the questions, length of the answers. Sometimes it gives 5 markers, sometimes it gives 15 markers, sometimes it gives 12.5 markers, sometimes it gives 20 markers. So it tries to surprise you in the exam. So all these eventualities, you should be prepared already, you should be mentally prepared. So that is why I am saying keep a watch, close watch on your enemy, so that you are well prepared for the exam. Then look after yourself. Nothing is important than yourself. No, not even this exam, because your life is more important than anything else. I understand that we are going through a turmoil. This is a tough time. We are amidst COVID crisis. We are facing tough time, and I know that many of you might not have been able to focus upon studies because of various problems at home. But now is the time, gear up now. There's a saying in English that a ship is safer in the harbor, but that's not what the ships are built for. So leave the harbor now, start sailing, start your voyage. Though the ocean is rough, sea is rough, but you are meant, you are built to start your sail, to start your voyage. And I am very much confident, if you are fearless, you'll definitely complete your voyage, and you'll cross this sea and you'll reach your destination. There's no doubt in that. Learn, practice, attack, and kill. First of all, learn the concepts, learn the fundamentals, clear all these things. Then practice. Practice, practice, and practice. Nothing else. That will make you rock solid in your subjects. Then attack. Keep this mental attitude of attacking mode. Always be in attacking mode. And finally, kill the questions in the exam. And this will come by a lot of hard work and smart work. See, in UPSC is not it's a different ball game altogether. It's not only about hard work, but it's about smart work also. You have to very smartly design your things. That is why we are decoding the syllabus. Because if you decode the syllabus, then very smartly you know which areas you have to cover and which areas you have to leave, so that your preparation remains streamlined and you cover your syllabus within a stipulated period of time. Otherwise, you'll be lost in a labyrinth and you will not be in a position to cover your syllabus in a very long period of, let's say, 4-5 years. Because geography is a very vast subject. We'll have to cover it in 2-3 months along with several other subjects. Be a clock, be consistent. I'm sorry for this. Be a clock, be consistent. Now that you have decided that you want to become a civil servant, now that you have decided that you want to prepare for civil services, now you should be very disciplined. You should be highly disciplined. Become a clock and become and be consistent. Consistency is the key to success. Do your work regularly and there is no doubt that you'll become successful, and do labor according, like work, make it a habit to wake up at particular time every day and do your work at make a proper schedule that everybody knows. So I don't want to talk about that in detail, but you should be diligent enough, you should be persistent enough in your efforts, then only it could be made. And I would like to congratulate you that for having made this decision to decision to prepare for civil services. This is not an ordinary exam, and I am pretty much sure that you are also not ordinary people. And I really look forward to you that you make to the civil services finally. Keep it short and simple. This is also very important. In civil services preparation, many people have this wrong notion that you have to write in very flamboyant language and very flashy language, then only you can score very good marks. No, it's not so. You have to be very succinct, to the point. Whatever has been asked in the question, only you have to answer to that point. Keep your answers short and simple, to the point, in simple language, the kind of language they use in magazine like Yojana. Have you ever read Yojana? Just go through the articles which are given in Yojana. Those are written by senior bureaucrats, the IAS officers, IPS officers. They write in very simple but effective language. Such kind of language we must use while practicing our answers, or while writing our answers, or the kind of language which is given in NCERT books. Now, resources required. I'll go very fast for this because we'll discuss these resources in detail in our classroom. But why I am discussing resources required is that you'll have to connect it with your syllabus, for decoding your syllabus. You don't have to read those books which are meant for optional, for geography or for any other GS subject, I would say, because many people are in this tendency whenever some very difficult question is asked in geography, and this usually happens, they have this tendency that they buy some optional book, some university textbook, and they start reading that book. Now, in this way, you cannot complete that subject in a year or 2 years. You have to stick to the basic textbooks, but you have to complete them intelligently, and I am sure you will be in a position to kill all the questions in the exam. We'll talk about this later on. So, resources required. Very quickly, I'll tell you what resources are required. All the syllabus is given in these books or resource material. Nothing beyond. All the syllabus will be fetched from these books. Nothing beyond this is required. Your NCERT books, your new NCERT books or old NCERT books, I'll tell you in the class which NCERT books are to be followed. G.C. Leong, for example, which atlas to be followed. Class lecture and notes, because NCERT books, G.C. Leong are not enough. They serve the purpose to an extent of around like 30-40%. So that is why we need class lecture and notes. Then newspaper, obviously, which newspaper to follow. We'll talk about this later on. Internet is indispensable these days, because some of the areas, some of the, if there is an issue of, or there is a concept which you are not able to understand from your textbooks or from newspaper, then internet will help you. This is indispensable, particularly for geography. Then Yojana magazine, then India yearbook, only some relevant chapters, 4 or 5 chapters. Then economic survey, again some relevant 4 or 5 chapters, I'll tell you in the class. And test series to assess yourself. Without test series, your preparation is half-baked. Okay, now coming to UPSC syllabus. Now this is important. What UPSC syllabus says, UPSC prelim syllabus, this has been given by UPSC. This, what has been given by UPSC is that Indian and world geography, physical, social, economic geography of India and the world. Only one line has been given by UPSC. Now, this one line, though seems to be very simple line, but it encompasses entire geography. That means, are they expecting us to read entire geography from the university textbooks, from BA, MA? Well, if they are expecting us to read those books, then we would not be able to complete geography in a time period of 5-6 years also. So we have to be smart enough to make a boundary, to describe a boundary, to decode the syllabus. That is why this session is important. That is why we have brought up this session. So Indian and world geography, physical, social, economic geography of India and the world. This we have already discussed, that geography have these components: physical, social comes under human, economic comes under human. Geography of India and the world, all these components are there. But this has very vast dimension. Now we have to shrink it to serve our purpose, so that we can prepare for our prelims properly. We can clear our prelims properly, and we do not need to study unnecessary stuff. All right. Now let's have a look at UPSC mains syllabus now. UPSC syllabus mains. Now let's see what it says. It says salient features of the world's physical geography. All right. Distribution of key natural resources across the world, including South Asia and Indian subcontinent. Now, South Asia and Indian subcontinent has been emphasized. So obviously, this is important area. This is Indian exam. We are preparing for Indian civil services. And obviously, you need to know more about the South Asia or Indian subcontinent or India. So we'll be focusing more on Indian counterpart. So that's why they have highlighted or emphasized this. Factors responsible for the location of primary, secondary and tertiary sector industries in various parts of the world, including India. Separately, they have mentioned including India, so that you do not forget. That means against, they have emphasized this. So our focus should be more on India, though we should not ignore the world part. All right. So that is how our preparation should be. India should be more emphasized in our preparation, and world should not be ignored totally, but less emphasis could be given to the world part. Now, they have mentioned 3 sectors of economic activities: primary, secondary and tertiary. They have not talked about the quaternary sector of industries. But to be on the safer side, quaternary sector of industries we will include in our syllabus, the decoded syllabus, because quaternary industries these days are becoming very important for several reasons, and every now and then they appear in the current affairs. So that is why we will include those in our geography syllabus as decoded part, though that that part has not been given in UPSC syllabus, but that is very important. All right. Now coming to this section, important geophysical phenomena such as earthquakes, tsunami, volcanic activity, cyclone, etc. All these phenomena are extremely important and they are very conceptual also, but very interesting to understand. Now let me give you an example. Volcanic activity. Volcanic activity, UPSC has just given two words, volcanic activity. In recent year, one question has been asked about one phenomena which is known as mantle plume. Now, mantle plume is nowhere has been discussed in your basic textbooks like NCERT or G.C. Leong. But this question was asked in exam. And this was a difficult question and many students were baffled by seeing this new term in the exam. That from where this question has appeared in the exam and they left this question. And this question was that what are mantle plumes and how they are related with or what is their role in plate tectonics. Now plate tectonics is given in NCERT. Volcanic activities are given in NCERT. But mantle plume is not discussed in NCERT and their role in plate tectonic is not given in NCERT. So that is why NCERT is not enough. But I'll tell you, everything is given in NCERT. You have to decode the syllabus. That is why I am saying you, hard work alone would not suffice. You have to be smart enough to prepare for UPSC. Everything is given in your basic textbooks. Provided you are smart enough to extract the information from those textbooks. You have to read between the lines, you have to read beyond the lines. Now I give you a cue. I speculated this long ago that this question could be asked in UPSC upon mantle plume and hotspots. Mantle plume, since we have not studied until now, so I'll not discuss this in detail, but mantle plume is a phenomena which is connected to another phenomena or another type of volcanic activity which is known as hot spot volcanism. Hot spot. Hot spot is a kind of volcanic activity which is not given in NCERT. But we had covered this in our class, and if you study about hotspot, then it is attached to mantle plume because hotspot volcanism occurs because of mantle plume. Now, how you decipher this? How I came to know about the mantle plume, or how I covered this this topic in my class? There is a figure which is given in NCERT in which location of hotspots are given in a world map in NCERT, class 11th NCERT, fundamentals of physical geography. Locations of hotspots are given and only one word has been given below that figure, that hotspots of the world. And nothing else has been described about hotspot in the entire book. Now, since that word has been described even once below a figure, that becomes important. Now, it becomes your duty to look for the meaning of that word which has been given in NCERT, which is hotspot, that what is hotspot. Now, here comes the role of internet. I told you what resources you have to follow. Internet, look for that word in internet, hotspot. When you'll search, basic research I'm talking about, you don't have to delve deeper into these concepts, because UPSC is not expecting you to become geographers or earth scientists for that matter. They are just expecting you to become bureaucrats or administrators or generalists who just have some basic knowledge about all the subjects. Jack of all trades and master of none. So if you do some superficial or some basic research about the hotspot, then automatically you will come to know about the presence of mental plume below hotspots. But the second thing is that nowhere it has been given how they are related with plate tectonics or their effect on plate tectonics. Okay, we'll discuss this question very soon. So this is how you actually decode your syllabus. So in our syllabus, we deliberately put this topic that volcanism, types of volcanic activities, subduction volcanism, rift volcanism, hotspot volcanism. So we covered this in our class. This is how we define the boundary of the syllabus. But this is not given in the syllabus which was given by the UPSC. If you go by the syllabus of the UPSC, then your preparation is half done. And if you go by the syllabus which you have decoded intelligently with a well-planned manner by looking at the past year questions, by looking at the basic textbooks or by your experience, then you are on the right path. You will not miss any question. Your basic textbooks will guide you. UPSC many times asks questions based upon the facts and figures or diagrams which are given in the books, not from the texts which are given in the books. Many times art and culture questions have been asked in such a way that a figure has been given, out of that figure the question has been framed, and people were looking in the text, but nowhere in the text that relevant material for that question was found. Now, earthquakes, tsunami, volcanic activity, cyclone, etc. Geographical features and their location, that is map work, etc. Changes in critical geographical features including water bodies and ice caps. These are contemporary issues. Environmental geography, environmental issues. And in flora and fauna and the effects of such changes. All this is the syllabus of paper 1. That is general studies. Paper 1 of mains, alright, and this remaining portion, that is major crops, cropping patterns in various parts of the country, that is our country India, different types of irrigation and irrigation systems, infrastructure, energy, ports, roads, airports, railway, etc. This falls under GS paper 3. Although this paper explicitly agriculture has not been mentioned, this term agriculture is not been mentioned, agriculture of India or agriculture of the world, but lot of questions pertaining to agriculture or allied sectors have appeared in the past or asked in the paper 1. Now we have decoded the syllabus and we have given a separate syllabus under the heading of agriculture. Why agriculture is important? Because you know that in India 50% of the population depends on agriculture. India has monsoonal type of climate. 50% of the population depends on culture. Even in the world, a large number of population still depends upon agriculture for their livelihood. So agriculture is an important what? Primary activity even till date. So that is why agriculture becomes important, and India is mentioned over here. So you have to decode syllabus in such a manner. So agriculture becomes one of the most important subtopics even if it is not mentioned over here, decode it and make a separate syllabus for agriculture. Now, what are the problems of agriculture? Different types of agriculture, subsistence type of agriculture, or what different types of agricultures are followed in different latitudinal areas or different countries, cropping patterns in different parts of the world. So all these things you have to include in your syllabus by your own, or what we have already done. We'll see the decoded part of the syllabus very soon. So this, only this much. This is for the prelims. Only this single line defines the syllabus for the prelims, and the single page defines the syllabus for the mains. Now, moving forward to the syllabus, what we have decoded. Syllabus decoded. General geography. We'll start from the general geography, though this has not been given in the syllabus by UPSC, but questions are asked from this area. And this is a very, some of the topics are dynamic in nature. A lot of discoveries are done in this area. So this is an important topic also in prelims as well as in mains. Many questions are asked. So this topic is, this section is general geography. We start our geography. Now how we have included this, how we have decoded, or how we have included this in our syllabus is that, with the help of textbooks, with the help of the past year questions, with the help of our experience, we speculated that what is the scope of UPSC, that UPSC could ask questions from this area. UPSC cannot ask beyond these areas. That is why I am saying go through the past year questions. That will give you a fair enough idea. If you want to score in mains, if you want to like solve all the questions, and it is pretty much possible that in mains, in your GS papers, you can solve 100% questions. In prelims, it's not possible that you can solve 100% questions, and in prelims you know that nobody gets 100% marks. Even the topper doesn't get 100% marks. But in mains, toppers usually, the rank holders, they solve all the questions, because they decode their syllabus properly. They cover each and every subtopic of the syllabus. They know how to decode the syllabus, either by themselves or by consulting the experts, by their teachers, or by their seniors, by whatever way, but they do this exercise. Once this work is done, then your preparation becomes very plain sailing. It becomes very smooth. It becomes a cakewalk. You just have to pick up the topic. You just need to prepare for that. So now your physical geography start. This is physical geography only, your general geography. Origin and evolution of the earth as well as the universe. Early and modern theories, integrating contemporary developments and discoveries. Now the story of geography starts. Geography is a very old subject. It dates back to 13.7 billion years. Its story is as old as 13.7 billion years old. Can you imagine that? 13.7 billion years ago, Big Bang occurred, and it's presumed that, according to Big Bang theory, that the universe came into existence. And in general geography, we try to understand how the universe came into existence with the help of the various theories. And out of the various theories, the Big Bang theory is the most acceptable theory which explains the origin of universe. which is very exciting theory to understand. It's also known as singularity theory. And from that, we proceed on to the theories which help us to understand the origin and evolution of Earth, because Earth has also evolved from somewhere. So all these are interconnected. These are very interesting theories, and integrating the contemporary developments and discoveries. In geography, it is very important to integrate the contemporary development and discoveries or contemporary issues. As a matter of fact, this is important for other subjects also, but I am dealing with geography, so I would say that integrating contemporary developments, if you learn this art of integrating contemporary developments with geography, then you get exceptionally good marks. We'll see the example very soon, what type of questions UPSC asks and how you deal with those questions. Though we are not going to solve those questions in this session, we'll hold a different session for that purpose. But today we'll just see how the syllabus is framed, how we decode the syllabus and what kind of questions are asked and how to deal with those questions. Okay. Universe and solar system, orbital and axial motion of the Earth and related aspects, concepts of latitude, longitude, local and standard time, international dateline. Though these topics, concepts of latitudes, longitudes, local and standard time, international dateline, these seem to be pretty simple, but they are, sometimes they become very confusing, particularly international dateline, local standard time. But if you visualize them properly, see, geography is all about visualization. If you visualize them properly, these concepts become crystal clear. If you visualize various phenomena, like in climatology, you have cyclones, anticyclones, you have air masses. If you visualize them clearly, if you visualize them in three-dimensional perspective, we'll make a lot of three-dimensional diagrams in the class. I'll teach you how to make those diagrams. You can make those diagrams in a jiffy. And everything will become crystal clear. In geography, you don't have to worry. You just have to understand. And if you understand them properly, if you can imagine them properly, if you visualize them properly, you don't have to remember the definition. You don't have to cram or mug up the definitions, because that will go in your, those definitions will be in your mind forever. They will just flow out of your mind in the exam. Now, physical geography, Earth dynamics. Earth dynamic means the movement of the Earth's surface or by the forces from the interior of the Earth, or how the Earth's surface moves and what are the repercussions of that, what are the effects of that, what happens because of that. Again, very interesting topics are covered in this, like seismology, Earth dynamics, seismology, earthquakes, seismic waves and their propagation behaviors, tsunami, landslide, etc. Though in your UPSC syllabus, only earthquake has been mentioned over there. Landslide has not been mentioned, but two or three times landslide, question on landslide has been asked. Interior of the Earth, sources of information, important role of seismology, shadow zones, composition, physical structure, discontinuities and different layers. Continental drift theory, evidences, critical analysis, convection current theory, seafloor spreading theory, paleomagnetism. Though all these are theories, you might be thinking that these theory may be very boring. But if you learn them in a way, in a story-like manner, one theory is followed by other theory. And if you learn them in a manner like a story, they become very interesting. And indeed, they are very interesting. And they are the fundamental theories of geography. If you understand these, they lead to a concept which is known as plate tectonics. If you understand all these things, like continental drift theory, convection current theory, seafloor spreading theory, then your fundamentals or concepts of plate tectonic theory will become rock solid. Now we'll come to concepts of plate tectonics, types of plate margins, related interactions, types of convergence, that is when two plates converge or meet like this, they collide. There are three types of convergence, CC, OC and OO. Now in the syllabus which has been given by UPSC, types of convergence have not been given. In your basic textbooks, in GC Leong and in NCRT also, types of convergence have not been discussed. But we have decoded the syllabus and we have included in our class notes all these types of convergence. And recently one question was asked and many students, they wrote wrong answer because they could not decipher the real meaning. They could not decipher the question properly. I'll discuss that question very soon in this session only. They could not decipher the question and they wrote a general answer to that question and they got below average marks. Otherwise, if you could understood that what type of plate boundary that was. So my point is that you have to go a little beyond what has been given in the syllabus, because that this is the syllabus which is given by UPSC. But the boundary, actual boundary is like this, which is little wider, which you have to create. But beyond this boundary, no question could be asked. If you are intelligent enough, if you are make a proper strategy, then no question could be asked beyond this boundary. But you have to do a little hard work for this. All right. So, and related landforms like Youngfold Mountains, island archipelagos, etc., and their prominent examples, global as well as Indian distribution of earthquakes and volcanoes. All right, we'll talk about all these things in the class. There is no point in just reading this. Volcanism, typology, this I discussed just now with you. Typology, this I included in the syllabus. Rift, subduction and hotspot. This is hotspot volcanism, which is connected to something which is known as plume. Mantle plume, volcanic features, extrusive, intrusive, advantages and so on, types of rocks, orogeny, etc. Let's move forward. Climatology, atmosphere, structure, composition, function, temperature distribution on earth, then atmosphere circulation, weather system, pressure belts, wind system, factors affecting wind movements. Certain concepts are bit difficult to understand. Coriolis force, for example. But again, it's all about visualization. It's very easy to understand. You don't go by the physics of Coriolis force. I've seen some people try to understand it by the formulas which are given in some university level physics book. But in geography, we do not have to apply the knowledge of physics, otherwise it's not geography. We are not here, it's not, geography is not meant, it's a open exam for all the, for students from all the streams, it's not only for physics people. But we'll understand it in a basic sense, in a perspective that people, students from all the backgrounds can understand the Coriolis principle, the Coriolis effect, how it happens. Otherwise, it's a bit difficult to understand. For example, jet stream also. Its role in Indian monsoon. In NCRT, jet streams have been defined, jet streams have been described, but not in a comprehensive manner, not in a very well elaborated manner. That is not enough for the exam. So, such topics you have to search on internet, because these topics you have to delve deeper. Because this is connected to what? Indian monsoon, jet stream, and that is a very important topic, because jet streams have a bearing upon Indian monsoon, they affect the Indian monsoon, and Indian monsoon is a very important phenomena which not only affects the culture life of Indian people. It also affects the cropping pattern of India, agriculture of India. So it becomes very important. And if you are intelligent enough to grasp this, then you know that jet stream, this subtopic in itself is a very important topic, then it requires some deep understanding. But jet stream we'll do in class, very deeply we'll go into this and we'll understand this properly. Okay. Now temperature inversion, its effect, temperature inversion, its effect, see, temperature inversion also, it's a phenomena. Two times question has been asked, once directly, what is temperature inversion and what is its implication on the local inhabitants. This was a direct question which could have been tackled directly from the knowledge which you have gained from NCERT. No problem in that. Direct question, no problem. But as I told you, these days UPSC asks very analytical questions, and once UPSC had asked very analytical, very difficult question in which they asked question indirectly, but the application part was that it was about temperature inversion only. We'll see that example very soon. How it was about temperature inversion, but there was no mention of temperature inversion in the question, but you had already learnt about temperature inversion in climatology. You just needed to connect the dots. You just needed to apply that part in the question. So that is why to this art of connecting dots, this art of analyzing or this analytical, developing analytical skills is very important for civil services. Okay. Now air masses, fronts, impact on regional climate, temperate and tropical cyclones, comparison of tropical cyclones and temperate cyclones, thunderstorms and tornadoes. These are very interesting topics. You will be mesmerized when we will do these topics in the class, and very important topics also. And climatology, I tell you, climatology is very important. Why? Because in prelims, in mains, lot of questions are asked. In physical geography, major share goes to climatology. Even in interview, I have seen in mock interviews, I have taken many mock interviews. So the senior bureaucrats particularly, they are very fond of asking questions from climatology, because what kind of climate, what is the changing pattern of climate in Delhi, or they ask about pollution or temperature inversion, new phenomena, because climate affects us. So even in your interview, some of the questions could be asked. So this is very important area. Now coming to these are some more topics of climatology. Water in atmosphere, absolute and relative humidity, saturation, dew point, condensation, clouds, smog, types of precipitation, El Nino, ENSO, La Nina, IOD, polar vortex, ozone hole, world climatic regions. This is all in climatology. Now, geomorphology. Again, very nice topic. Geomorphology deals with landforms, various agents of gradation like moving water, moving air, they make landforms, etc. And this we need to study in this. And very beautiful landforms are carved out by these agents. And this is though in past many years, no questions have been asked from this area, but that doesn't mean that this is not important. Area or important topic. In future, you don't know, many questions could be asked from this area. So you can just have a look at the slide. Now coming to oceanography, ocean floor topography, division of ocean floor. Oceanography is a very small topic but very conceptual, and questions more or less are direct, which are asked in the exam, barring few. Otherwise, they are direct. Ocean currents, causal factors, types, contribution in desert formation, effects on regional climates, fishing, navigation, vertical and horizontal temperature distribution, vertical and horizontal distribution of ocean salinity and its effects. Now, I tell you, one question was asked in past year about change in ocean salinity and its multi-dimensional effects. Now, UPSC asks certain questions which are like very analytical, I told you, which are thought provocative. You have to think then and there. If you learn this art and this, here comes the role of test series. Now, maximum what happens under the pressure of the exams, multi-dimensional effects of change in the oceaning salinity. Students can write maximum 1, 2 or maximum 3 effects, but you are supposed to write at least 5 or 6 effects. If you have practiced a lot in your test series and if you have developed this out of box thinking, then you can write many dimensions of the effects over there in the exam. Tides, types, causal factors, important tides, navigation, fishing, resources of the oceans, wave, motion of waves, characteristics of waves, coral reefs, coral bleaching. Alright, then biogeography deals with soil characteristic, soil formation, soil profile, etc. Soil degradation, erosion, conservation. Then types of natural resources, natural vegetation, forest, significance of forest, etc. Deforestation, conservation of forest, such type of topics. Then we have world geography. So continent wise coverage of world geography will be done. There is no decoding in this as such. This is a simple straightforward topic. But what type of questions they usually appear in the exam, I must tell you. I will give you examples also. The questions are not from the books as such. The questions are from current affairs generally. I'll show you by example. Otherwise, we'll do in class, we'll cover the map, the world physical geography, continent wise, like important mountains, important rivers, important plains, important forest areas, important grasslands. Everything will be covered continent wise, important ones. But very few questions are asked from those areas, but still you need to know, because in mains, for substantiating your answers in mains, that is very helpful. And obviously in for your interview also you are preparing, so you must have a good knowledge of world physical geography. Okay, then because of the paucity of time, or because there is no point in reading this, I want to move forward to the questions section. I'm not reading all this. You can just have a look at the slides. I'll just put the slides forward. Just have a look at this slide. This is syllabus of India Physical Geography. This is a decoded syllabus of India Physical Geography. Remaining part of India Physical Geography. Drainage system of India. Classification, remaining part. India physical geography is very important. Majority of the questions are asked in prelims. For mains also this is very important. Obviously we have to serve our motherland, so we ought to have good knowledge about the physiography of India, about the physical geography of India. Major soil types of India, factors influencing their formation, and you can read the rest of all the rest text. Then human economic geography, basics of economic geography, resources are very important, you can read. Agriculture. Special focus or emphasis should be given on agriculture. This is a very important sector. Then industry also. This comes under secondary, primary, secondaries for industry, secondary sector. Transport. Demography and census. This is all human geography. Settlements and urbanization. Human development. All right. Now we are coming to the questions which are asked by UPSC, so that we have an idea and how we tackle those questions and what learning we can have from those questions. Learn from the past, outwit your enemy, that is UPSC. How we can learn from the past and how we can outwit UPSC. 2015 UPSC Civil Services Prelims, this question appeared in 15. The question says, which of the following national parks is unique in being a swamp with floating vegetation that supports a rich biodiversity? Now the options are Bhitarkanika National Park, Kibul Lamjao National Park, Kevla Dev Ghana National Park, Sultanpur National Park. See, this is an example of very easy factual question. In this case, either you know the answer or you don't know the answer. It's not conceptual question. So answer over here is B for Bombay, that is Kibul Lamjao National Park. But the learning is that if you would have gone through the past year papers, you could have easily solved this question. How? The learning is that 2 years prior to this, that is in 2013, this question was asked in 15. In 2013, 2 years before, this question was, one question was asked which was pertaining to Loktak Lake. Now Loktak Lake is situated in Manipur, and if you would have done some basic research about Loktak Lake on internet, you would have came to know about this national park, that there is Kibul Lamjao National Park inside Loktak Lake. It's given even in Wikipedia, and it is known for its unique in being a swamp with floating vegetation, with rich biodiversity. It's a very famous national park over there. Simple basic research. Just make a noting somewhere in diary and you are prepared for, and after 2 years you reaped the benefit of the past year question. This is a learning we get from the past year question. This is why I emphasize that you should go through the past year question, and also you came to learn that this is the typology of the question UPSC asked. Though this was easy and factual question which everybody could have solved in the paper. Anyways, now second learning which we get from this question is that because UPSC has incorporated all these names in the option, that means that all these national parks are significant for one or the other reason. So you should also focus upon these national parks and do some basic research and make notes. Maybe in future, maybe after two years or 3 years, or when you are preparing, when you are attempting, question may arise. This happens sometimes. So this is the way you should prepare. All right. Now analysis is that this was easy, factual. This should be attacked and this should be killed if you are well prepared. Another example from 2016 prelims. Question says, consider the following pairs. Now on the left hand side, famous places are given. On the right hand side, regions are given, geographical regions. Place number one, Bodh Gaya is matched with Bagelkhand. Khajurao is matched with Bundelkhand. Shirdi is matched with Vidarbha. Nasik is matched with Malwa. Tirupati is matched with Rayalaseema. The question is, which of the pairs given above are correctly matched? Now this question seems to be a bit difficult. It's not that easy because it has so many matches. Secondly, it is a multiple choice question, so it becomes bit difficult. But if you are intelligent enough, if you smartly do some work, you can solve this question in a jiffy, like very quickly. How? See, which is the weakest link over here? Where is Malwa Plateau? Since our childhood classes, in our childhood classes we have learned in geography, this everybody knows, that Malwa Plateau is in Madhya Pradesh, okay, in central India. Madhya Pradesh, As a matter of fact, Malwa Plateau is in western Madhya Pradesh and some part of southeastern Rajasthan. And to be precise, it is north of the Vindhyan range, Vindhya Mountains. And Nasik is south of Vindhyas. But we do not have to think so much deeply about this. Only fact which is important is this, is that Malwa Plateaus are in Madhya Pradesh and Nasik is in Maharashtra. So this is the weakest link. Everybody knows this. So you just have to, this is wrong. You just have to eliminate those options which contain four, statement four. So eliminate this, this contains four, eliminate this. Now you are left with only C. So C is the correct answer. This technique is, you must be knowing, this technique is known as elimination technique. And in UPSC, some of the questions could be solved. Many times this helps. And UPSC deliberately forms questions to test your elimination technique skills, because this is also analytical skill only. This is to check your intelligence, whether you can eliminate or not. All right. And if you go by your knowledge, then Bodh Gaya, you know that Bodh Gaya is a famous temple. In history, you might learn. Now, this is a question of, this is connected dots. In history, you learn about Khajuraho. In history, you learn about Bodh Gaya. You know that Khajuraho, which was built by Chandela Rajputs in 1010 AD, it's in Bundelkhand region only. Okay, so it's a correct match. Bodh Gaya is not in Bagelkhand, because in geography you learn that Bodh Gaya is in Bihar, and Bihar is predominantly a plain area. It's Indo-Gangetic plain. So Bihar is, Bagelkhand is a plateau. So this is a wrong match. Shirdi is not in Vidarbha, though this is difficult. People who are from Maharashtra, they can easily tell, but for us this may be difficult. Shirdi is not in Vidarbha. How it is not in Vidarbha, we'll know. This is wrong. And Tirupati is in Rayalaseema. This is correct. We'll see. But very close. This is very close. How this question was framed also, and how we actually make our syllabus, how we have to connect it with the current affairs also, we'll discuss this, because there is a purpose why I'm discussing this question. Okay. So again, we land up over here only. That answer is 2 and 4. This is wrong. Nasik, Malwa. So answer is 2 and 4, C. 2 and 5, I'm sorry, C. Now let us see. This was difficult, though it was factual. You have to defend in this case. Wait, if you are sure, then kill it. Otherwise, you can leave. And technique, elimination technique is the best thing for such questions. You can safely do this. Now let us see for the position. This is your Bagelkhand plateau, and this you can see is your Bihar. Bihar, Bagelkhand plateau is completely outside Bihar, and Bundelkhand plateau, Bundelkhand plateau is over here, and we have Khajuraho temples in Bundelkhand region. Now why this question was framed? This question was framed because all these religious places, Shirdi, Tirupati, Bodh Gaya, all these religious places were on the religious circuit. There was a religious circuit on the drawing board by Government of India. So it was in news, constantly this was in news. So this was taken from current affairs, and this comprises of static part, your geography knowledge. It tested your geography knowledge also. So it had dynamic part also, it had static part also. Why dynamic? Because taken from news. So if you followed news, you could have solved this question. Okay, these places are there, but you were supposed to have some fair amount of knowledge of geography also. Now let's have a look. Finding Vidarbha. This is Maharashtra, okay. This shaded region is Vidarbha. And this district over here, this is Ahmednagar district, in which your Shirdi, Temple of Shirdi falls. So it is, though it is pretty close to Vidarbha, but for us, this is very difficult to tell. All right. Rayalaseema in Andhra Pradesh. This region, this shaded region is Rayalaseema, and this district is Chittoor. In Chittoor district is situated Tirupati temple. So this is a correct match. Okay, now this question appeared in 2016. In which of the following regions of India are shale gas resources found? Now this is a factual question, direct question, though moderate. Why moderate? Because this was not in newspaper, this was maybe some not so important news may be given in the newspaper, but otherwise from where it was sourced I will tell you. In which of the following regions of India are shale gas resources found? Cambay Basin, Kaveri Basin, Krishna Godavari Basin. Select the correct answer using the code given below. A, B, C, D. Okay. What is the correct answer for this? C. Shale gas resources are found in all of these areas. Cambay Basin, Kaveri Basin, Krishna Godavari Basin. So answer is D for Delhi. That is 1, 2, 3. All the areas. This was given in your economic survey of that year. In economic survey, this report was given that shale gas resources are found and in these areas, and government is working for the exploration of for the extraction of the shale gas reserves in these areas. That is why I told you, don't run after for many books. Only certain government books and basic books will suffice. You have to dig out for the syllabus. You have to connect your syllabus with those books, and that will work for you. So this question appeared from your economic survey, and though it was moderate, but if you had done your economic survey, then it was easy for you, factual, and you were in a position to kill this. Now let's have a look. This is your Cambay Basin region. This is your Krishna Godavari Basin. And this is your Kaveri Basin. All these are known for shale gas reserves. Okay. Another example from 2015 prelims. Each day is more or less the same. The morning is clear and bright with a sea breeze. As the sun climbs high in the sky, heat mounts up, dark clouds form. Then rain comes with thunder and lightning, but rain is soon over. Which of the following regions is described in the above passage? Now this forms an example of conceptual question, though not very difficult, it's moderately difficult, but G.C. Leong, it's given as it is in G.C. Leong. If you follow G.C. Leong, it's not difficult, and if you understand the concept that this happens in equatorial areas, so it's talking about the equatorial type of climate, okay? Equatorial region. Because the sun, the morning is clear, bright, the sea breeze. As the sun climbs high in the sky, heat mounts up, dark clouds form, then rain comes with thunder and lightning. We'll study about this in climatology later on. But this is the type of questions, and your basic books actually suffice. Moderate, conceptual, defend, wait, kill. Otherwise, if you have not followed your basic books, also you will not be able to solve that. Now map based question, let me give you an example. 2014 UPSC prelims. Turkey is located between Black Sea and Caspian Sea. Black Sea, Mediterranean Sea, Gulf of Suez and Mediterranean Sea, Gulf of Aqaba and Dead Sea. Very simple question. Answer is Black Sea and Mediterranean Sea. See, from where this question has been sourced. For map marking, we do lot of study. That is good for our understanding. That is obviously good. We do lot of study, but we do not do smart study. We actually have to augment our study. We'll do continent-wise coverage of the important geophysical features like straits or seas or like the important countries which are falling between different, or like the mountains, peaks, etc., rivers, etc., or the important ports. But the most important countries, or you can say the most important areas or the aspects for map marking, are those which are in current news, which are in, you have to connect it with the contemporary issues. You know that when this appeared in 2014, this appeared because of the ISIS crisis in West Asia. That was in much focus. So they asked this question, that Turkey is located between, because Middle East or West Asia was in focus because of the turmoil which was going over there. So they asked this, Turkey is located, though this was easy. But our learning is that this was asked in 2014. Now see this, this was easy and factual. Now see this, 2014 and very next year, that is in 2015, they asked which one of the following countries of Southwest Asia does not open out to the Mediterranean Sea. Again, this is very simple. Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Israel. So when you are, you know that when you are going through newspaper, you know that there's so much of turmoil which was, there's so much of political unrest which is going in West Asia, particularly in Syria and regions around like Jordan, Lebanon, Israel. Then it becomes imperative to look into the map and look for the regions around, like what all seas are there, what all important mountains are like Golan Heights, what all important rivers are there. Because questions, it's very probable that UPSC could ask question from there, and UPSC asked in 2015. So out of this, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, all these are coastal countries. These share coast with the Mediterranean Sea. Jordan is landlocked. So answer was Jordan. Now see, after 2015, again in 2017, that is after two years, they asked similar question, but this was difficult. Mediterranean Sea is a border of which of the following countries? They were so fond of asking this question. Jordan, Iraq, Lebanon, Syria. Now you already know, if you had gone through the past year question, now you know that Jordan is wrong. So just eliminate Jordan. A and D are gone. Now you know that Lebanon and Syria are right. Okay. So Lebanon and Syria are where? 3 and 4. So 3 and 4 are contained where? Mediterranean Sea is the border of which of the following? Jordan is landlocked, we have eliminated this. So Iraq, Lebanon and Syria, 3 and 4, C, because Iraq is wrong. Iraq doesn't share border with Mediterranean. So 2 and 3 cannot be right. You definitely know that Lebanon and Syria are correct. So if you go through the past year questions, or if you keep a tab on current affairs, then you are well prepared for the exam. Map marking questions are also generally asked. Sometimes one or two questions may be asked from non-contemporary areas or from conventional textbook. Otherwise, they are generally asked from your current affairs. This was bit difficult, though factual, difficult for those people who do not follow newspaper and who do not follow past year questions. Okay. Apart from winds, movement of ocean water is influenced by 2015 prelims. Temperature differences, density differences, external force of sun, external force of moon. Choose the correct answer using the codes below. Now this question asks what all the factors are responsible for the movement of the oceanic waters. Now you know that external force of sun and moon are responsible for the creation of the tide. This is correct. But the students got confused because of these two statements, temperature difference and density difference. Okay, temperature difference, obviously it will create movement or induce movement in the oceanic water because of the temperature, water swells up. And when it swells up, it generates currents. All right, we'll study about the generation of the currents, how the currents are originates at the equatorial positions. So this is also correct. This is correct, this is correct, this is correct. Now density differences also induces movement in the oceanic waters. So all of the above, all are correct. So this was bit difficult, conceptual, defend, wait or kill or leave. Okay, such type of questions are asked which are conceptual. So we'll discuss about this after we have done oceanography. But everything comes from your syllabus, but syllabus should be now. Okay. Let me tell you, I missed this thing. This is given in NCERT, but these two points are not given in NCERT. But we have to decode our syllabus in such a manner, or we have to do these points in the class itself. It's not necessary that we write all the points in the syllabus itself, but we have to cover all the aspects, that what all aspects are necessary, that like in currents itself, causes for the generation of the currents, then we'll cover in the class that what are the causal factors for the generation of the currents. Then we'll cover that temperature, that is insulation. So from that, there we'll connect the dot, that temperature, insulation, density also. Why density? Because thermohaline circulations, we have great conveyor belt. We'll do this after oceanography, we'll connect. So dense water, saline, dense cold water sinks down. So this happens and conveyor belt runs all across the ocean. So all these we cover, and this is not given in NCERT. So this is the need. That is why there is a need to define a proper boundary for the syllabus so that we can cover such questions. Now this question is an example of extremely difficult question. Just have a look. I'm not going to discuss or read this. Just have a look by yourself. And if you encounter such a question and you have no idea for such question, it's better to leave this question, because I told you nobody attempts 100% questions in the prelims. If you are very well prepared, then you are in a position, you'll attempt around 90 to 92 or 95 questions you can attempt. 90 is a safe bet you can attempt. 100 you can never attempt. Extremely difficult, conceptual, leave. Or if you are extraordinary in geography, then you can attempt this also. Now coming to mains answers. Now let's see this example. This is a very good question which was framed by UPSC. It appeared in 2015. Very conceptual and analytical question. And many students were not able to decipher this question. Many students. Only few students were able to understand this question, and that too partially. They couldn't write satisfactory answer to this question. Why? Because they couldn't write. They couldn't write multiple dimensions to the answer this question, and they couldn't integrate, or they couldn't like connect the several dots. Let us discuss this question, because this is very interesting question. This is not answer writing session, so we'll not write answer, but just how to connect the dots and like how we will integrate it with the syllabus. So Mumbai, from where, for how to integrate it with the syllabus, everything comes from the syllabus. Mumbai, Delhi and Kolkata are the three mega cities of the country, but the air pollution is much more serious problem in Delhi as compared to the other two. Why is this so? See, this question, nowhere it has been given that this question is talking about temperature inversion. Though this question is about temperature inversion. Temperature inversion, which we have talked about, it's a topic of climatology, it's a subtopic of climatology. But nowhere it has been mentioned. But you know that this is a geography question. Why? It talks about pollution, it talks about mega cities. All right. So first of all, this point should come in your mind, that what is the difference, basic difference between Mumbai, Delhi and Kolkata. Immediately it comes in your mind that Delhi is a continental city which enjoys continental type of climate, and Mumbai and Kolkata are coastal cities which enjoys maritime type of climate, or coastal type of, which maritime type of climate. Delhi is landlocked. So because of that, what happened in Delhi, there's something, a phenomena which is known as temperature inversion. What happens, particularly during the winters, the ground surface becomes excessively cold, let's say to the tune of 2 to 3 degrees centigrade. So the air which is in contact with the ground, which is very close to the ground, also becomes excessively cold, let's say 4 degrees centigrade. And the air which is aloft, which is above it, remains warmer. Let's say it is 7 degrees centigrade, hypothetically. So warm air is now over the cold air. The air which is in contact with the cold surface is colder and it is below warm air. So what will happen? Because of this, there will be no movement of air, because warm air will not move down because it is lighter, and the cold air being heavier will not move up. So because of this, there will be stability in the lower atmosphere. Stability means there will be no movement of air. No movement of air means whatever pollution is created in Delhi, whatever pollutants, dust particles, smog, smoke, will remain suspended there for a very long period of time. They will be kind of locked in the lower atmosphere for a very long time, because there will be no movement of air. It's like you put lot of poisonous gas in a container and you close it by a lid. So it will become very, very poisonous inside the container. So the position becomes something like that. That is why you must be remembering few years back, Delhi had very severe smog, which was even compared with the London smog. This phenomena is known as temperature inversion. Because Delhi becomes excessively cold in winters, because it enjoys continental type of climate. It is not surrounded by oceans, or it is not surrounded by seas. It's not close to any sea or ocean. On the other hand, Bombay or Kolkata, they are very close to sea. So they enjoy maritime type of climate. They do not become excessively cold. So this temperature inversion phenomena, when the ground doesn't become excessively cold, this temperature inversion phenomena doesn't happen over there. So particulate matter, this suspended particulate matter or pollutants, do not get locked over there, do not get suspended over there. All right. So this was the first point which you needed to discuss. Multi-dimensional answer. First dimension, which is geographical dimension, that is climatic dimension. First, inversion. Okay, second, there is another climatic dimension or geographical dimension. You have one more phenomena which is known as continuous exchange of air via sea breeze and land breeze in Mumbai and Kolkata, but which is absent in Delhi. So this continuous exchange of air in Mumbai helps the removal of pollutants in the city and in Kolkata also, but this continuous exchange of air is absent in Delhi. So the sea breeze, land breeze also you could have discussed in like 20-30 words, and coupled with diagram also over here, also diagram. In geography, diagram is must. You should make diagram. Number three, I add another dimension. See, think about all the topics of your syllabus. Think about agriculture. Now think, can you integrate agriculture with this answer? Yes. One agricultural problem was there in news of this region, the hinterlands of Delhi. That is the Delhi surrounded by very agriculturally productive areas of Punjab, Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh. So you must be knowing, problem of stubble burning is still there. And recently in November 2019, Supreme Court has lashed government of Punjab, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh that please stop this stubble burning. This is a major cause of pollution in Delhi, which is absent in Mumbai and Kolkata. So, third point you could have written, stubble burning. Okay, fourth point, now add social dimension also. What social dimension? During that time when this question appeared, Delhi government introduced one policy over here, odd and even policy, you must be knowing, that on one day even number cars will run on the roads and on one day odd number cars, just to curb the pollution. Why this happened? Because one report appeared that in Delhi there is a culture of using more private vehicles. It's a social attitude over here. So it's a social dimension which you could have written. So in UPSC, think about many dimensions, write as many dimensions as possible, but those should be relevant. So private vehicles, more private vehicles in Delhi, and these four points, few diagrams, your answer is done. You'll get fabulous marks for this. Okay, now connecting the dots, this dot you learned in your NCRT. This dot in your NCRT or in your, even in your GC Leong. This dot in your newspaper, let's say The Hindu. This also The Hindu. Then what is the need to study those voluminous PhD or voluminous MA books of geography, when you can write fabulous answers from these basic books? All the syllabus can be, just dig out the syllabus from these basic books. That is why I discussed this particular question, and this was difficult question. Everything can be done from basic books. Some of the topics which are which cannot be done and which are important, which we think from our experience, we will do in class properly to that level which is sufficient for the exam. We will not go too far. Okay, so this is enough, and you just have to connect these dots. You have to interweave them to write a beautiful answer, and you will get good marks for this. And your job is done. Now, analysis is that this was difficult, conceptual. You needed to connect the dots. You needed to integrate contemporary developments. The last two points were contemporary developments. One was from the agriculture sector, one was from the social. One was the social dimension from the society. Okay. Now, 2017 mains. How does the Juno mission of NASA help to understand the origin and evolution of the Earth? You know that in general geography we have discussed, there is a topic, origin and evolution of the Earth. How does the Juno mission of NASA help to understand the origin and evolution of the Earth? This news appeared in newspaper, that Juno mission of NASA, what is the purpose of the Juno mission of NASA? Let me tell you, Juno mission of NASA was launched to unravel the secrets of Jupiter, the largest planet of our solar system, the gas giant. Okay. So how does the Juno mission of NASA help to understand the origin and evolution of the Earth? The question, try to invest at least 30 seconds to understand the precise requirement of the question. Now, what the question actually demands, Juno mission of NASA, as soon as the students, they read this answer, they started writing, okay, Juno mission of NASA is launched to understand the origin and evolution of you see Jupiter and it will do this and that, and there were so many facts and figures which were given in the Hindu or Indian Express for that matter, and they just wrote all those points blatantly over there. This is not the way you should write answer. You should think in a way, you have to write a geography answer. Connect your geography syllabus, your dots properly. It should appear as a geography. It's a geography answer, obviously. Current affairs coupled with geography, it should appear as a geography answer. You should have started your answer in a way that there are theories like Nebular hypothesis. There are various other theories, but the most accepted one by the scientific community is Nebular hypothesis till date, which explains the origin and evolution of Earth. But Juno mission of NASA has been launched to understand, to unravel the secret of the origin and evolution of Jupiter, which is the largest member of the planet family of the solar system. So it's pretty obvious, once we understand how it evolved or how it originated, it will throw a great amount of light on the origin and evolution of our planet Earth also, because we are the member of the same family. You'll understand this once we have done that chapter. So integrate it with those theories also, name those theories also. Nobody named those theories. Nobody integrated that with that chapter. So they got below average marks, like out of 10, maybe 1 or maximum like 2. If you integrate it properly, if you write multidimensional answer, 2-3 points, it should appear as a geography answer, then you will get easily 5 or 6 marks also. And that makes a difference between selection and rejection. Okay. Why are world's fold mountain systems located along the margins of the continents? Bring out the association between global distribution of fold mountains and earthquakes and volcanoes. 2014 mains. First of all, let me tell you this question, although with due respect to UPSC, it never does this, but this question is wrong, technically wrong. This question should have been, why are world's young fold mountain systems located along the margins of the continents? Bring out the association between the global distribution of, then again this word should have been inserted over here, young fold mountains and the earthquakes and volcanoes. Then this question is correct. Anyways, let's ignore that. Why are the world's fold mountain systems located along the margins of the continents? Now you'll not come to know why I have inserted that word young. You'll come to know that later, at later point of time. See, as soon as students, they read this question, immediately they started writing, okay, fold mountains are formed because of the tectonic movement of the plates when the plates collide. Plates collide, and because of the collision, the folds are formed and the mountains are formed, orogeny happens and blah, blah, blah. So this should not happen, because this question comprises of two parts. First part is specifically asking, I told you, keep it short and simple. What has been asked, only give answer to that question. Otherwise, you won't get marks. There is a catch over here. It's not simple. It appears to be simple, but there is a catch. The catch is this: located along the margins of the continents. Only few students noticed this and they wrote the perfect answer for this. I told you, we included in our decoded syllabus types of margins. There are three types of convergent margins. We have CC convergence, we have OC convergence, we have OO convergence. You'll come to know this in the class. I'm sure you are able to see this. I'll draw this again. The three types of convergence: CC, OC and OO. Out of this, only these two types of convergence lead to the formation of fold, Young fold mountains. So C means continental. One plate has to be continental. Only then Young fold mountains are formed. If two plates are oceanic, then island archipelagos are formed and continent and Young fold mountains are not formed. This you should have discussed over here, over there. All right. This is why your syllabus should be decoded properly. And this happens when your syllabus is not decoded. This is a flaw. This happens when you do not decode your syllabus. Then you lose your marks and you do not understand the concepts properly. You do not, there's a deficiency in your preparation in that case. Why is India taking keen interest in resources of Arctic region? See, this question appeared because of current affairs. It was in news in that year, 2018. Although we expected this question to appear in 2013, because India gained observer status in 2013 in the Arctic Council. Though this appeared after a long period of 5 years in 2018, though there was no major news in 2018, but UPSC sometimes frames question from minor news also, or which are like not so major news. There were two news items which appeared in newspaper pertaining to the Arctic region. One was about China, that China unveiled a policy about building a polar silk road through the Arctic region, which was very important, because you know that whenever China unveiled any policy about any oceanic route or trade route, it becomes very important, particularly for us, for Americans also. So that was important for us strategically also. So that news becomes important. So that news you should have covered, and how you integrate it with your syllabus. Oceanic routes, trade, transport is in your syllabus. Now this news item, like they unveiled this policy of polar silk road, which is nothing, polar silk road through the Arctic, which is nothing, but it's a policy of opening oceanic trade route. Now in the Arctic region, because of the global warming, the possibility of opening of new oceanic sea routes is seen. So various countries are eyeing this area. So this news appeared. So because of this news, this should have been marked by you. And those students who were like observant enough, they took a note of this. And this news and this question appeared actually from this because of this news. Why India is taking keen interest in the resources of the Arctic region? And there was another news which was like this, India to expand polar research to Arctic as well. Until now, India had only polar research stations in the Antarctica. Now there's a strategic shift that India is opening up its research in Arctic also. Recently, its National Center for the Antarctic and Ocean Research, which is in Goa, has been renamed as National Center for Arctic Polar and Ocean Research. So this is very important strategic shift in India's policy. So that is why it becomes very important, and you should not miss such type of news articles, and you should make your notes. Why Arctic is important? Why India is so much keenly interested in the Arctic region? Now the question, this report or this article which appeared in the Hindu was actually about, it was a holistic article which talked about our commercial interests. India has actually commercial interests, scientific interests, it has environmental interests, and it has strategic interests also. So it has four types of interests. So students, they make notes, they made notes, they read this article from the Hindu. This was important article because they knew that Arctic is an important region and India is now focusing upon the Arctic region. So what mistake, but most of the students, they did, as soon as they read this question, they just started pouring out every fact and figure. They wrote that opening up of new routes, setting up of new scientific centers, setting up of scientific centers for environmental studies. So all the factors, all the dimensions they wrote. But the question specifically demanded of only why is India taking keen interest in the resources of the Arctic region? This you had to identify. And resources, you know that resources is a very important topic of geography. So that is why this was important article which is attached to geography. So you had to identify in the newspaper, okay, this is resources. Arctic region is a resource region, natural resource rich region. It's a resource powerhouse. It's a storehouse of natural resources. We'll talk about this, of the world. So obviously this becomes important. So but we needed to talk about only resources, not about a strategic focus or strategic interests or scientific interests or environmental interests, only commercial interests, that is resources. Keep it short and simple, to the point, what has been asked in the question. Okay, so what happens because of the global warming, these resources, there is a possibility of finding resources. Now it's a fact that Arctic region holds about 10 to 20% of the global reserve. Now that is huge. And natural gas to the tune of around 30% of the global reserve. Can you imagine that? And iron ore, the region falling in the Arctic, within the Arctic Circle, are extremely rich in iron ore. You must be knowing this. And other than that, the continental shelf area is extremely rich in polymetallic nodules also. So you must have discussed about all these points, then you would have fetched good, very good marks. Okay, now to make it a geography answer, you connect it with what you have learnt in your oceanography. You know that continental shelves are extremely rich in resources, many resources, mineral resources, energy resources, for example petroleum, natural gas, polymetallic nodules, etc. So over here, show your knowledge that Arctic continental shelf, which is attached to the Siberian coast of Russia, is the largest continental shelf of the world. And Arctic region or the continental shelf area of this region is the largest continental shelf of the world. That is why India is keenly interested in this area, because this consists of the huge reserves of natural gas, petroleum, iron ore, polymetallic nodules, etc. And India is an energy starving country, energy deficient country. Moreover, there is a political turmoil, political instability which is going on in West Asia. So India needs to diversify its market or source regions to import hydrocarbons. All right. So that its dependency is not, it doesn't remain dependent upon one country only. Then after global warming, because of the melting of the ice, Arctic will, there will be possibility of opening up of very rich fishing grounds also in the Arctic. It's already being called kitchen of the Europe. So India also wants to have a share in that fishing ground also. So connect it with the food security angle also. And connect the petroleum, natural gas with energy security. energy security angle also. If you write such points, you correlate, you write a cohesive answer in a well-planned manner, you'll get marks. Okay. So everything comes from your syllabus. Syllabus is resources. This was in news. So just pick out those relevant things, which is those relevant things which is important for your geography. If you do this exercise, you will be able to answer all the questions of geography. And this is why decoding the syllabus, because every decoding the syllabus is important, because every like subtopic of geography should be in your head, should be in your mind. Define mental plume and explain its role in plate tectonics. Now this was very difficult. Mental plume and explain its role in plate tectonics. I have already discussed what is mental plume and its role in plate tectonics. Now, after we have done plate tectonics and mental plume and volcanism, then we'll discuss this question in the class itself or in our forthcoming session. Right now, I am skipping this. Bring out the causes for more frequent landslide in the Himalayas than in the Western Ghats. Now, see, this question appeared in 2013. Why more frequent landslides? Why frequent landslides occur in Himalayas and Western Ghats? You need to understand the physiography of Himalayas. You need to understand the physiography of Western Ghats. Himalayas are made up of weak sedimentary rocks. Western Ghats are made up of hard igneous rocks. Himalayas are tectonically active, fall in the tectonically active region. On the other hand, Western Ghats fall, they are tectonically inactive. There are several other factors also. Himalayas, mechanical weathering is more pronounced in Western Ghats. Mechanical weathering is subdued. So there are several points. The point is that when this question appeared, many students could not find sufficient points to write to substantiate this answer. Though good amount of material is given in NCERT in a box, so sometimes students ignore such boxes or certain diagrams or certain figures which are given in NCERT. So these should not be ignored. I would repeat, UPSC are looking for observant people who are very keen to understand, who are very keen to, who have this quest for knowledge, who have this thirst, who have this hunger for knowledge, who are keen to learn, and that is why they test your keenness in the exam from the basic books only. Then again, after 3 years, they ask almost a similar question. The Himalayas are highly prone to landslides. Discuss the causes and suggest suitable mitigation measures. Measures of mitigation. Now, half of the part is same. Himalayas are highly prone to landslides. If you have gone through the past year question, half of the question is prepared, though it seldom happens. UPSC usually doesn't repeat, but it helps to does helps. Discuss the causes and suggest suitable measures of mitigation. Causes, you know, suitable mitigation measure. Now this is the applied part, and this is like, this needs some brainstorming then and there if you have not read it somewhere, but you can write suitable mitigation measures with suitable diagrams also. If you have done a lot of practice in your test series or like self at your home also, you can write very well answer. You have to think like an administrator, think like a manager. You have to manage a district. So eventually you have to become IAS officer, think like an IAS officer. If you are district magistrate in a district, how you will do, what steps you will take to mitigate the measures of landslides. And these topics invariably you will learn in your disaster management also. So such types of questions are asked. What do you understand by the theory of continental drift? Discuss the prominent evidences in its support. This is the easiest question I have seen from geography, as it is from the NCERT book. The whole text is given. The easiest question, what do you understand by the theory of the continental drift? Discuss the prominent evidences in your support. Just read NCERT, write it over there, very simple theory. No easy question I have seen as this question. Now 15, major hot deserts in the northern hemisphere are located between 20 to 30 degree north and on the western side of the continents. Why? Now this is moderately difficult, though your basic textbook, your NCERT, G.C. Leong would help you. But conceptual question, you need to understand it properly. See, major hot deserts in northern hemisphere, even in southern hemisphere for that matter, are located between 20-30 degree, let's say around 30 degree, are on the western side of the continents. Why? You have to integrate various points which you have learned in like climatology and oceanography. In climatology, you know that around 30 degree you have subtropical high pressure belt where there is no cloud formation mechanism because of the subsiding air. It creates high pressure at the ground. So no clouds are formed, so no rainfall, dry conditions. But then why on the western side of the continents? Because let's say since this is not Australia, on the western side you have this desert area. Why on the western side of the continent? Then you have Tropic of Capricorn. You have cold current over here. Okay, so cold current have desiccating effect. Since many of you may not be able to understand, so we'll discuss this later on. But one reason is on the western side you have cold current which has desiccating effect, because of that also. Another reason is that the trade winds over here, the trade winds are offshore. The trade winds, when they cross the continent, they become offshore and they become dry when they reach over this position. So that is why on the western side, and also this is subtropical high, STH. So these are the factors. So if you connect like this current you learn in oceanography, subtropical high, trade wind, etc., you learn in your climatology, and you integrate them and you write answer, you make one or two diagram, and that is more than sufficient for your, this was a direct question. So moderate conceptual, connect the dots. 15, explain the factors responsible for origin of ocean currents. How do they influence regional climate, fishing and navigation? Again, direct question which can be tackled very easily provided you have good conceptual clarity. In geography, conceptual clarity is very important. Explain the factors responsible for the origin of ocean currents. How do they influence regional climates, fishing and navigation? This we'll discuss after we have done climatology. They have huge impact upon human beings, climate, fishing and navigation, ocean currents. What characteristics, this is 2017 mains, what characteristics can be assigned to monsoon climate that succeed in feeding more than 50% of the world population residing in monsoon Asia? Now again, students committed this mistake. As soon as they read this question, immediately they started writing without understanding the precise requirement of the question. The demand of the question was different, and they started writing the mechanism of the monsoon. That, okay, this is the mechanism of the monsoon, they drew the diagram, which was not the demand of the question, and the examiner just struck off the answer and marked zero, awarded zero marks. Otherwise, what was required, simply you needed to give characteristics characteristics of monsoon, which feeds 50% of the population, and just a regional diagram of Asia, South Asia, some Indian Ocean, Southeast Asia. You know that monsoon Asia comprises of Indian subcontinent, South Asia, Southeast Asia, South China. So these parts, just make a diagram which shows this region, shade them, and no need to write about mechanism of monsoon, no need to make that diagram which shows the movement of the monsoon winds. Just write about the characteristics of monsoon. See these monsoon, mechanism of monsoon, agriculture, these are very important topics. So all the questions actually come from the syllabus only. You just have to follow the syllabus. But the syllabus which is given by UPSC is not enough. The world is not enough. You have to define a proper boundary, which is a bit more. It should not be much more, so that you cannot do that. You have to define a proper definite boundary so that you can handle it properly. It should be streamlined properly. How do ocean currents and water masses impact marine life and coastal environments? Give suitable examples. Now, this appeared in 2000 mains. This question also baffled many students just because of the introduction of this new term, water masses. Because ocean currents is nothing new, everybody knows about this. Water masses was a new term which many, almost all of the students didn't know about this, and they were baffled, they were surprised by looking at this term, and they wrote just partial answers. Now, UPSC, see, you're preparing for, this is UPSC after all, you're preparing for civil services and you are destined to become IAS officers, and this is how UPSC will surprise you in exam or shock you in exams. And you have to be mentally prepared for such circumstances or eventualities that you may find. And in classes also, it's also not possible to teach each and everything in the class, but we'll prepare you mentally to handle such situations in the class, that how to handle such eventualities in the exam. In the exam, if such questions appear, how to intelligently handle them, because what you are going to become, you are going to become public managers. You're going to face such situations which will surprise you day by day, and you'll have to handle them eloquently, elegantly. So in exam also, you'll have to manage these situations. So how do ocean currents and water masses? Now, there's a term, water masses impacts marine life. So this term actually irritated students. Water masses, as soon as you saw this term, read this question, think for a minute, not a problem. You equate this with a term which you already knew, which you learned in your climatology, that is air masses. You know that air masses are big masses of air which have homogeneous properties, which are of moisture and temperature horizontally. So you can equate them. Similarly, water masses have homogeneous properties of, these are big volumes of water which have homogeneous properties of temperature and salinity. If you could have done this in exam, you could have fetched marks. So in exam, you can handle this. And we'll solve this question later on in our answer writing session. And so nothing is difficult. Only thing is that, first of all, make a proper strategy. Go in a sequential way. First of all, go through the syllabus. Go through past year papers. Then decode the syllabus properly. And by heart the syllabus, connect those terms which are given in the syllabus with like whatever you are going through in newspapers, current affairs, and your basic textbooks also, then you'll be on the right path of your preparation. And wish you all the best, and thank you so much for this wonderful session, and do take care of yourself. See you soon.